Stanford University.
Okay, welcome back, everyone. So the second talk, final talk today, in fact, is Siegfried Glenzer, who's going to tell us how to make a star in the laboratory.
Yes, thanks a lot. All right, so my name is Siegfried Glenzer. I'm professor for photon science here at Stanford. I'm also the leader for the high energy density science program here at SLAC. So high energy density science and stars have something very much in common. And I think I will show you that. And I'll also show you, I'll demonstrate to you how we do high energy density science here in the laboratory using SLAC X-rays. At some level, even using fast electrons to measure the structure and the conditions of materials in very extreme conditions, in extreme environments. So how to make a star in the laboratory? Let's first talk about why we want to make a star in the laboratory. So we will talk about the world energy supply. We will talk about the terawatt challenge and why energy needs big solutions. Then we talk about laser-driven fusion. As you know, there are many approaches to fusion, at least three or four. And I will show you the beginning of the laser-driven fusion program. It's a national program. That means many laboratories in the United States are working on it, and we are one of the partners. The main effort is going on at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory. That's where the facility sits. And here we are part of the team that actually I was working there before. I was one of the main experimentalists before I came here. Now I'm a team member, and we are figuring out the physics that is needed to be figured out in order to demonstrate fusion in the laboratory. All right, then I will show you some recent successes, and then I will show you how we actually figure out the questions that need to be solved in order to demonstrate a star or to make a star in the laboratory. And I will talk about our program here at SLAC and how LCLS is a unique tool to determine the physics of fusion plasmas. So I will show you that progress in fusion research and high energy density science will be important for the future for all of us. So that's the terawatt challenge. So let's give you an idea of energy needs here on our planet Earth and give you some numbers so that you know what we're talking about. So our max are all work with a watt of power. That's not a big deal. A toaster, however, needs a little more. It already needs a kilowatt. I think that's a picture of the TGV. It needs like a megawatt of power. But in order to power a whole city, like the city of San Francisco, we need a gigawatt of power. That means we need a power plant. So a typical power plant actually provides exactly that, is a gigawatt. And however, to power a whole planet Earth, we need terawatt levels. Actually, the whole electrical power on Earth is roughly, I think, 3 or 4 terawatts. But the whole energy, including all the stuff that we are burning, is about like 15 terawatts or so. Somewhere in that range. And so terawatt, that means we need of order 10,000 plants if you wanted to get the electrical energy supply of our world, all done without burning gas in our cars and without burning oil in our homes. So that's the scale we are talking about. So it's a big problem, and it needs a big solution. So let me tell you how people have solved those issues. So this is our world energy consumption now. So oil is clearly still the leader. And what you notice here, coal is in black. And you saw the last decade, coal has really risen a lot. That despite the call for renewables, coal is clearly the fastest rising energy. That's been burned in order to supply the energy that we need. Because the gas is rising. And then here you see renewables is just a tiny little dip here at the end. So right now we have 17 terawatt total average power in 2013. So those numbers, of course, have already beyond that. And the projected is for 2015, we need 28 terawatts. So why is coal so much rising? And why is nobody paying attention? So those are two things we should have in mind. And the reason is pretty simple. Coal is cheap and abundant. Of all the production cost of electricity, coal is clearly the cheapest one, 1 to 4 cents per kilowatt hour. And we have reserves for 200 to 2,000 years. The upper level is not so clear, but it's plenty. And when I gave this talk a couple of years ago, people were saying, oh yeah, solar is coming down. And solar is important. But I checked this morning, and the prices are still exactly that. So if you are in a third world country, you see this bar, that's the energy of choice. And here's the evidence for that. So this is our plot that shows how coal is increasing, change in consumption since 2000. Red shows increase, gray shows decrease. And we see like South Korea, Japan, South Africa, Russia, primarily India and China, they start to burn coal, and they burned a lot of it. And even countries like Germany and the United States that really have a search for other energy sources, they just barely held constant. Reductions are really small. And that comes with all the crap that comes with coal. The CO2 emission, as you know, during the Beijing Olympics, coal plants had to be shut down in order to have the Olympics to occur in Beijing. They had to be shut down for months. And after the Olympics, of course, they got turned on again. And of course, you have coal mine disasters. That's a picture, it's 2 years ago. Many people even die getting coal out of the earth. So what people did, they came together and said, in order to prevent further climate change due to CO2 emission, we really have to change what we're doing. And what people said, we want to have a trillion ton threshold of CO2 in the atmosphere. So right now, we have accumulated CO2 of 545 billion tons in the atmosphere. So here what is happening, of course, there's land use change due to primary deforestation. Agriculture is a big change here. And then there's fossil fuel consumption is the rest. And you see here are the five biggest emitters, is the United States, China, Russia, Germany, and the UK. And you can see it's really, we're really putting on a lot of CO2 in the atmosphere. And so people try to prevent it, of course. We had those various climate deals. There was just another climate meeting in Paris. So we try to keep it to the trillion ton threshold. So how are people doing? And I pick up an example of Germany because that's my native country, that's where I was born in. So people really try to make coal consumption about flat or slightly rising. And here's what happened. So there was 6.3% of the energy were renewable in 2000. And within a decade, that was risen to 25%. Big increase, big success, people pointed it. What was the cost? The cost of doing that increase was $100 billion of surcharges to the electric bills. Energy in Germany is 3 times more expensive than in France, for example. Loss of competitiveness, and that amounts to roughly $70 billion of export loss. So the question is, how can this be a global model? If only one of the richest countries in the world can actually afford to do anything about CO2, and then just barely just does a dip. Maybe we really have to change of paradigm in how we deal with energy. Now, of course, if you don't do anything about it, you all know the consequences. It has been very publicized, has been very discussed. And just to give you an idea, this is a glacier, the Pasterze glacier in Austria, 1875. Here's how it looks today. Just gone. Then here, you see this picture. This is, of course, a cartoon overlaying many storms. More energy in the atmosphere, more energy in the ocean. Everything is warmer. That means more storms, more powerful storms are hitting our coastlines. So what people want to do, they want to limit our global warming to 2 degrees. What this really means is that we have to have a lot of non-CO2 producing energy sources. That's what that really comes down to. All right, so what is the energy source that we all know and love that is not producing CO2 is, of course, it's the sun. And the sun's energy is based on nuclear power. It's based on fusion. What's happening in the sun, you fuse hydrogen to helium. Actually, that was how helium was discovered. People looked at the sun and saw spectral lines and then said, oh, those spectral lines, they're new. They must come from the sun. That's why helios. And later on, helium was also found on Earth. So, and why is nuclear fusion the choice, nature's choice? It's because it's the most efficient way to get energy out. There's no process that can produce energy better than through fusion. And the way it's been attempted right now, or one of the ways it's been attempted right now, is through imploding a millimeter capsule to a microscopic star in the laboratory. And the way this works, that's the subject of this lecture. All right, so fusion is widely accepted as an attractive future energy source. So why is that? It's simply because the fuel is abundant. If you were to fuse deuterium to tritium or to helium, we have one deuterium out of every 6,500 atoms on planet Earth is deuterium. It's highly abundant in the oceans. That means there's no, every nation that has access to an ocean has access to plenty of deuterium. So it's inherently safe. There's no runaway process, there's low residual heat after a fusion power plant goes into maintenance mode and it's been shut down or something. And here's why. A fusion capsule is typically 2 millimeters in diameter. It mostly consists of CH on the outside, and I will show you why we need CH in a minute. Then we have silicon dopants, that's the dark ring. And then if you look at the inside, you can barely see it. There's a layer here on the inside, and that's the layer of our nuclear fuel. That's dense DT or solid density deuterium tritium mixture, or deuterium tritium ice. So for example, here we have 0.17 milligram of nuclear fuel. And that, of course, poses no danger if it was released into the atmosphere. I should also say that this will burn a few minutes supply of fuel at a time. What that means is you will burn this much, it's burned, and then you have to replace. Then you do the next experiment to replace this fuel layer with a fresh one. And in the best of all worlds, you would do this at 66 hertz. That means 66 times a second, you would burn this amount of fuel. And what that really means, burning, is you have that fuel, and think about a pile of wood, and you put a match to it, and you're burning it. That's the goal of what you want to do here. You want to burn this amount of fuel in a single event. All right. It's inherently safe. There's no high-level nuclear waste. Even if you would shut down a fusion power plant, after 100 years, you wouldn't know that it ever existed. And of course, people have been calling for fission to step up, to replace coal, to be the future energy source. And that call has been renewed over the decades, but nothing has happened. Fission is not the political choice at the moment, and the question is, when is it going to be the political choice? We'll see. But those are pictures that are very recent still. They're just protests, the protests over shipments. Those are in Europe, and of course, we all know what happened in Japan after the tsunami disaster. Pretty much Japan shifted from a fission energy country to a country that uses conventional fuels that put CO2 in the atmosphere. So another point of fusion, I told you the supply of fuel is abundant. It's in the oceans. It's just deuterium. You can separate deuterium from hydrogen easily. So there's no, the energy doesn't come with any baggage. There's any political dependencies. So right now, here's our energy dependence on natural gas, how Europe is really dependent on Russia, and we all know about the conflict of the Ukraine and the dependence of gas supplies from Russia and how that can be a political factor in decisions and you know in the in this case of the independence of Crimea. Okay, another point is people believe that it can be scaled. That means enough power plants can be built with efficient land use to really supply a major part of the world's energy. That means we have sites like this. This is the ITER site in the Provence in France. So what's happening here, this is a magnetic fusion power plant that has been built. It's called ITER. And you can see it is pretty big. That would, for example, be needed in order to power a city such as San Francisco. But remember, we need like 10,000 of those to power the planet. All right, and then finally I told you there are no greenhouse gases. And the reason is it's nuclear energy. I also told you nuclear energy is the energy with the highest energy density, of course. That means you only need a very small amount of fuel, and you only need to burn a small amount of fuel in order to get a lot out. And that's been shown here. This is the binding energy per nucleus, in MeV per nuclei. And a fission plant, for example, works like this. You have uranium, and you split it apart, and nuclear energy becomes free. You go to iron, which is the top of the curve. That's the amount of energy that gets out. And it's a lot. However, fusion still beats that. You can see it here. If you fuse deuterium to helium, that means to alpha particles, that's essentially the most efficient way to get energy, the most efficient way that we know to get energy. And that's the goal of our research. So let's talk about fusion cross-sections. So this is our cross-section for like three processes. There are more processes around. So what is happening in a fusion process? You take a deuterium atom, proton and neutron, you fuse it with tritium, proton with two neutrons, and what you produce an alpha particle plus a neutron. In total, they have 17.6 MeV of energy. So our alpha particle carries 3.5 MeV, and the rest goes into the neutron. So now, this is the DT process. And from this scale, this is a kinetic energy. This is our cross-section. This is the one, if you can ever make fusion work, this is the process we're going to make work first. So I tried to make a little sketch of this, and which is shown here. So this is thermonuclear fusion. That means we have particles that move around fast. So what do you guys think we need to have particles that move around fast? What needs to happen in order for fusion to occur?
Because you want them to bounce into each other and just merge.
Exactly. You want them to bounce into each other and submerge. What is preventing particles from bouncing each other and to fuse? The Coulomb repulsion. So we have to overcome the Coulomb repulsion. That means you have to have enough energy into the collision process in order to overcome Coulomb repulsion. There's a little bit of quantum mechanical tunneling into our cross section, and then you can actually make them stick together. So in order for this to happen, that means you have to have a velocity distribution function. That means a temperature such as this. When you increase the temperature from 5 to 10 to 20 kilovolts, you have more and more particles at higher energy to just overcome the Coulomb repulsion. So, and if you have our fusion cross-sections such as those, all we have to do, we have to integrate over these two distributions, or these two functions, and see what comes out. That means this is our rate of a fusion product, shown here. It's N1 times N2. This is our first particle, our second particle. And then it's about 1 plus delta 1,2. Delta 1,2 is a Kronecker delta. Why do you think we have a Kronecker delta? No? This is simply to take into account if it's D and T, fine. But if it was all deuterium, you want to make sure you can only, if you have one deuterium and another deuterium, you can only fuse the pair once, right? You don't want to double account. So that's what this Kronecker delta is for. And then this is the simple integral, the two functions. There's our cross-section, our velocity distribution function, and we have to to integrate them over our velocities. And what's important here to realize is, of course, those are spheres in energy space, really. And we take the delta or the difference between the two energies, which matters in our binary collisions scheme. And then we get our cross section. We can define like this: sigma v, sigma is our cross section, which is velocity average. That means it's average our velocity distribution function times the densities, and this is our fusion rate. This is the number of reactions that we have. And what is shown here, this is simply the red function, is where the velocity distribution function overlays with the cross section the most. And this is a very famous peak, it's called the Gamow peak. And if you integrate this up, that tells you effectively how many fusion processes are going on. So what are the primary or the principal requirements to make fusions work? Well, is number one, I've already shown it here. We need high. Nobody? What do we need? What is the sun? Yeah, go ahead. You need high temperature, correct. What else do you need? You need high temperature and you need high? Pressures, yeah, that's very good, high pressures. Principle comes down to high temperature, high pressure, and high density. And the more particles are there, the more fusion occurs, the better it is. But it is actually, you need it for more than that reason. You also need high densities for other reasons. And that's actually shown here. So the tellurium goes to tritium. You produce an alpha particle and a neutron. The neutron just gets out. It carries energy away. It doesn't stick anywhere. But look at this. There's still an alpha particle with 3.5 MeV energy. That means the fusion process produces a particle with energy. And the goal is to keep that energy around. You don't want to let it go to waste. That means if you have a high-density plasma, such as the sun or our microscopic experiment, you want to stop that alpha particles inside the plasma. By doing so, you're heating the plasma further. That process is called alpha heating. Sometimes called bootstrapping. That means once you start fusion process, all of a sudden it takes off. So that's what you need to do. You need to stop this guy, and so that the energy sticks in your plasma. So now there's one problem with this, right? I told you we have plenty of deuterium. It's all around in the ocean, but tritium is not. So why is tritium not around? People know? Yeah, the half-life of tritium is what? It's, I think 13 years or something. So it just decays quickly. That means we have to breed tritium. We have to make it. Unfortunately, it's very easy to make. What we need to have, we have to have lithium. Take lithium, we take our neutron, and we produce more helium, we produce tritium, and we actually have more energy if you do so. That means most fusion reactors, they have our steel structures and plasma holding components or whatever you need, and they have a lithium blanket. And that lithium blanket is breeding tritium. And actually, by breeding tritium, we actually make more energy. So pretty cool. That means you gain more. So that's our DT process, right? Deuterium plus tritium makes an alpha particle plus neutron. So now there's also the DD process, which is going on automatically. You can't avoid it when you do this, because the DD, the deuterons will also fuse among each other. And what they do is they produce helium-3 and they produce another neutron. So in many cases, what people do, they look at a neutron at 2.45 MeV, one at 14.1 MeV, and they actually have an idea of what's going on. What is the temperature in your plasma? It's actually a nice diagnostic feature. This occurs. And of course, you also have this process. It means you also produce protons, which are also nice as a nice diagnostic feature as well, if they get out. So some measurements are such, you try to you want to see that those guys are disappearing in the detector. What that means is once those guys are disappearing, we start to alpha heat. That means our alpha will also stay in the plasma and will deposit its energy. All right, and then I have one more guy here. So all of these processes, of course, produce neutrons, and people don't like neutrons. A lot of people don't like neutrons. Okay, I heard the first part, the high energy, the second part was?
There is no charge, so it's very difficult to like interact.
Well, they can interact with lithium.
Yes.
They can breed.
They can make radioactive
Right, they can activate materials. That means, for example, I will show you pictures of the fusion experiments at Livermore. Everything is made of aluminum or stainless steel. Nothing high Z around, because once high Z stuff is around, you activate it and it just radiates forever and poses a danger to humans. Actually, those processes, just because the neutrons are very dangerous. And as you know, when you come here to SLAC and you go to the accelerator, you all have to have a radiation badge, because radiation is dangerous. And those fusion experiments are dangerous too. So they're all happening behind a wall of concrete. Actually, the wall in Livermore, I think, is like at least two times this podium in thickness, at least. So, people don't like neutrons for that reason, right? They activate materials and they're dangerous. Actually, is that they hit the nervous system, they can, if enough fusion processes are still around, they just make your nervous system functioning to completely come to a stop. And that's probably the fastest way to die. So since people don't like neutrons, but they're so smart, they're saying, oh, why don't we do fusion and boron 11 with a proton, we make three alphas. Yeah, very smart idea. Of course, people knew about this process for many, many decades. It's nothing new, really. But there are always politicians that like to listen to these smart ideas. Unfortunately, though, when you look at this, this is a PB cross-section. It peaks around here. And now reads the same value over here for DT. That means the plasma that previously has to be of order KeV temperature now has to be of many hundreds of KeV temperature. So if you cannot make a DT plasma burn, you will never make a boron proton plasma burn. Just no way. Just the requirements on temperature are so much higher. Despite that fact, people here, Nobel Prize winners, companies are all out there trying to sell this to the US government and to private investors that this is a great idea. It is a great idea, but if you cannot do DT, you will never do that. So, and we have not made DT work yet. So it's at some level, one step at a time. So I'll tell you about how we try to make this one work. Once this actually goes, does anybody have an idea how to make this one work? Anybody? Right. That's called an advanced fuel. Once you burn DT, the energy density will be so high, then you can bootstrap it to that temperature, and then you can heat that guy. This is all known. That idea is around for 50 years. But it requires one step at a time. OK, so kinetic energy. So maybe we should talk about electron volts and KV. We've talked a lot about solids. We should talk about the unit of an electron volt. An electron volt is 11,605 degrees Kelvin. And now that means KeV. That means you're talking 10 millions of degrees. And you talk about this at solid density and beyond, actually at 50 times solid lead or 1,000 times water density. Those are very high temperatures, very high energy densities. All right. So here's how the big picture looks like. Here's what people believe they need. They need a laser driver. It may not have to be a laser driver. That's just what people think of at the moment. It can be a particle driver. It can be any driver. What you need a target, which can be injected inside of a chamber. You heat up the target. You make fusion work. And you have to do that many times a second. That means you have to have target fabrication. You have to have a plant that produces targets and that injects them all the time. And then the neutron gets out, the energy is carried by the neutron gets out. That means you have to have a lithium blanket. That means you have to have heat transfer. And you have to have a fuel cycle, of course. And then it goes this way, you have a heat exchanger, then the lithium gets to be put back, and that now you can make steam, you get turbines to go, and you produce electricity. That means, actually what people believe, you probably need to order 10 to 100 hertz operation, or targets per seconds. So it's more than 10, probably less than 100, to produce a gigawatt of electricity to power a city such as San Francisco. All right, and here's how it works. So you have a gigawatt, but in order to put a gigawatt onto your grid, you really need to produce 1.3 gigawatt. Because 0.3 gigawatt you put back into the cycle. So put it back into the cycle, here's the 0.3 gigawatts. This is the power that goes back into a power plant that drives the driver, laser, particle beam, whatever it is. And I'll say it's 10% efficient. That means we really only have 30 megawatts. Or what that means is that corresponds to 3 megajoule at 10 hertz. That exactly makes up that number. That means you have 3 megajoule of energy now per event in order to drive your fusion process. So 3 megajoule of energy sounds like a lot, it's actually not that much. So that means you have to have a target gain that cranks up this number by a factor of 100. And you do it 10 times a second, that means you get back to 3 gigawatts. And now you have 43% reactor walls and turbine efficiency, so now you're back to 1.3 gigawatts. That's how the cycle works. But the key is you need a high target gain. That means the target needs to get 100 times more energy out than you got in. Okay, and here's the idea how it works. So it's the deuterium and tritium, you bring them together in a hot, dense plasma. You fuse them. The way it works is our cross-section with rock and temperature. So first what you do, you're compressing the material. You make it dense, and you form a hotspot. Once it's hot enough, the alpha particles stay in your plasma, they keep heating the plasma further. Alpha heating starts to set in, that means you work up higher in temperature. And then once you're high enough, then you have dense fuel around. You start to ignite the dense fuel around, you have a burning wave that burns up all the fuel that is around. And the way it works, you have a 2 millimeter fusion capsule, you have a capsule ablator. Many people use CH, but I believe very soon people will get away from CH, partly because of experiments that we have done here at the methane extreme condition instrument at SLS, which will I allude to in like 30 minutes or so. So at the inside you have DT solid, which is just DT ice. Just sits on the inside, has been put into the capsule, and then just freezes that way. And there's always a finite amount of vapor pressure. That means there's also gas in the middle. Just as happens how this has been set up. Now you're compressing it. 10 hours a second later, that's what remains. It's imploded DT core. It's less than the diameter of a human hair. And those are actually real data. Those are actually the first shots on NIFs that were taken. Actually, I took those shots. Okay, so efficient burn requires high fuel rho r. So we should talk about rho r. Rho is the density, needs to have high density. And rho r means area density. That means the density of mass that sits on a shell in our fusion capsule. So, and here's the reason why you need high rho r. So I told you want to stop the alpha particles. So that's why it needs to be high density, of course. But then also look at this table. You could think of we don't need 1,000 gram per cc, just 100, or just 1 gram per cc. But what that means, in order to stop our alphas, if the density is lower, that means that the plasma just has to be much bigger. The plasma is much, that means the radius of our sphere goes up. So now you assemble a huge amount of DT. If you really would do that, and generally would start to launch a burn wave, you have so much fuel around, you cannot contain that. That means you would have a huge explosion. And there would be nothing left of your power plant. And that's the reason why people want high density to have a good manageable amount of energy coming out per event. Okay, that's this. And we should also talk about the burn-up fraction. I saw this nice demonstration that you had of all the students up here. So people said, oh, I have a neighbor here, but another there, so I go over here. Right? So now, in a dense, hot plasma, if you assemble it, the same process sets in, actually. So I will keep that demonstration for future lectures. So it's a very nice one. So what is the fastest motion if you have a plasma densely assembled? It's actually what you just demonstrated itself. It's the sound velocity, right? So that's how a typical perturbation of the ions is happening. That means you eat away the edges of your plasma, and you actually eat it away at the sound velocity or at the sound speed. And what that means is you just lose material. It's called a rarefaction wave. So that means you never burn up your whole ball or the whole plasma that you assembled. Because when you start burning, the edges are already being lost at the speed of sound. So we have to talk about a burn-up fraction. And if you do some more math, which if you're interested in, we can do that together in one of the breaks, you come to that equation. So the burn-up fraction is rho r or rho r plus 6 or rho r plus 7, something like that. So if rho r is pretty high of the order of 3 gamplers, you see you burn away about 30% of your fuel. And that's a very good number. But even 10% would be great, actually, because at the moment we burn much less than that. So now this looks like a solid ball, right? But that's not what we are doing. So and the answer is here, but just think about it for a moment. Don't even look too much on the slide. There are just numbers here. Why do you think it's a bad idea to compress a solid ball of material? Nobody? OK, let me rephrase the question. Why do you think it's a bad idea to compress something like this as opposed to a sphere? OK. Let's think about it. It takes also energy to compress matter, right? So if you compress more matter than you really need to compress, you waste a lot of energy in your compression. It means you always want to compress as little mass as possible, just to be most efficient, and also to be most economic. So that is shown here. If you were to compress a solid ball, the energy in the fuel, you can just calculate it. It's called an equation of state. If you do that, you need 130 kilojoules of energy in order to compress just solid material like that. And if you compress less material, just a sphere, you only need 10 kilojoules of energy. So there's a factor of 10 right there. That means here you need a driver of the order of 10 megajoules, or probably much higher. Those numbers are always optimistic, right? And here you need driver of order megajoule. And probably the truth is you probably need 3 times as much. But we'll see. That's still an open call that still needs to be figured out. So it takes less. If you have less mass to compress, you need less energy. That means you are more economic. So then this is how it looks like. You have a rho r probably here of 1.5 gram per cc. That means the fuel that is surrounding the hotspot that sits here is only 10 microns in diameter. Remember, your human hair is 50 to 100 microns. So it's a tiny, tiny amount of fuel that sits here. And as you compress in the interior, I told you there's gas here from the vapor pressure. Just automatically it's here. It forms a hotspot just because you're compressing it. And the idea is, of course, that the hotspot is so hot that it ignites itself from the compression. And of course, in the best of all worlds, it would go to 10 kilovolt at 100 gram per cc and a radius of 30 microns. And those are numbers that come from sophisticated computer simulations. This is what the experiments are aiming for, but have not achieved it yet. OK, so here's one other thing. Here's how it looks like in a plot. But what it really comes down to is to this. So you want to heat a small amount or a small fraction of dt. And so this is Fermi degenerate compression. That means if you have material that is hot and you want to compress it, is that easier? Or is it more difficult compared to material that is cold? You all got this little thing, right? This little this guy. Okay, if you think it's easier to compress warm material, do this. If you think it's harder, do this. Not both. one or the other. But I see more. I see a few yellows. I see a few, but I see more reds. So the majority is actually right. So if material is warm, it's more difficult to compress. You want it to be as cold as possible to compress it. So, and we call that Fermi degenerate compression. What that means is all the electrons are as cold as possible, but they're still like in a solid, typical solid, you know, the Fermi energy of aluminum is like 13 eV. Simply, the electrons cannot go to lower states because they're all occupied because of Pauli exclusion principle. That means this is just the Fermi energy, and you want all the electrons as close to the Fermi C level as possible. You don't want a Maxwell distribution. You don't want high energy electrons around because it prevent compression. So, and if you were able to keep it cold and compress it in a cold manner, this is the energy that you need. This is a specific energy, 10 to 7 joule per gram. So it doesn't matter how much you compress, this is per gram, this is the energy you need. But if you look at the specific energy from DT fusion, you see it's still much less than the energy per gram that you get out of a fusion process, which is good, right? Because you always produce much more energy by fusing it than you need energy for compression. So now what you can simply say, this is our, the total energy in the fuel is here. And you want some ignition margin. That means you say this, the implosion velocity should probably be twice the energy that is required to compress our fuel. And we want to get to 1,000 gram per cc. That means we have to compress at a velocity of 360 kilometers per second. This is how fast we want it to compress. So now, this is a material that compresses that. And it compresses by ablation pressure, and I will have a picture of that in a second. That means mass is ejected this way, and material moves that way. That means you need to have a rocket equation. What that means is in order to compress by 360 kilometers per second, you need to have an exhaust velocity of 120 kilometers per second. And what that means is an ablation pressure of 100 megabar. That means the pressure that you put on the outside of the capsule needs to be 100 megabar in order to get that much energy in here. Okay, and that means you have a radiation environment of 300 eV. That means it's the radiation temperature that produces 100 megabar on the capsule. And radiation temperature, just think about the sun. How do people measure the temperature of the sun? Anybody knows that? The color, right? The Wien's displacement law. And what they find is at what where is it mostly? What is it? The wavelengths of its highest emission? Do you know that too?
Green.
Yeah, it's green. That's right, and that corresponds to temperature of. Anybody?
6,000.
Yeah, 5,850 or something. So the surface temperature of the sun is 6,000. The surface temperature of the radiation enclosure for our fusion capsules needs to be 300 times 11,000. So it's a really hot oven, or it's a hot radiation environment. And actually, the detector that we have to measure that type of radiation, it's called Dante, after Dante who looked into the inferno, because that's what this is. It's the environment to include a fusion capsule is an inferno. And then here's what it does. So you have ion temperature versus compression. You compress it, you get it to peak velocity about here. And then the temperature doesn't rise much further. At this point, only slightly, until alpha heating sets in at the highest density. And then the alpha energy sticks in the plasma, and then your temperature rises up. So it's alpha deposition and burn. And that's how you get to 50 kilovolt ion temperatures. And that's when you can think of burning a boron proton plasma, actually, as well. In any case, it goes to that high temperature density, and then you have decompression, and it falls down. Okay, what it means is we need high energy density science conditions in order to make this all work. So high energy density science. Of course, people have built particle colliders. You have one particle here, one particle there. You collide them. You also produce high energy density conditions. But they are not high energy density conditions useful for fusion. They're just particles. If they burn, you don't get energy out. When we talk about high energy density science, we talk about having mass around that you can burn. That gets a substantial amount of energy out. And that's hard to produce. So let's just think about the binding energy of a hydrogen molecule is 10 to the 11 joules per meter cubed. So this is it's like a megabar. So the core of Jupiter is 80 megabar. So one bar, remember, is atmospheric pressure. So 80 million bar is the core. Still not enough. The sun core is 3 times 10 to the 5 megabar. So 300,000 megabar, still not bad. A fully burning fusion target would be 2 million megabar. So that's the pressures that you need to achieve. So those enormous pressures, those have not been achieved on Earth just yet. But in order to do that, many years ago, we started to build one fusion experiment that is shown here. There are others. I showed you a picture of Cadarache, France, of ITER. This is the aerial photograph of the National Ignition Facility in Livermore, 50 miles from here. Since then, there's also a laser in Bordeaux that's been built. There's Shengwan 3 or 4 that's been built in China with similar goals to produce fusion plasmons in the laboratory. So this is how big it is, like 3 football fields. But since we all watch now soccer, UEFA World Cup, so 2 soccer fields. And here, of course, that's the idea. Matter temperature, 10 to the 8 degrees Kelvin. Radiation temperature, I already mentioned, 350 eV or 300 eV. 1,000 times compressed material, 1,000 gram per cc, and pressures of 10 to the 11 atmosphere, and higher. So truly high energy density science conditions. And here's how it works. So those are my former colleagues. Most of them are still working out there. So let me just mute this. So this is the control room. It just looks like the control room here at SLS. So just a few big computer screens. People launch the shot process. It's shown here. You charge up capacitor banks. And then you have a fiber laser. And the fiber laser produces a laser pulse shape that is a few feet long, and then you feed this into the shapers that shapes the spatial profile. And then you get this into the main laser amplifier. So the laser light is traveling down here into the amplifier. There's neodymium glass. They're charged up by the big capacitor discharges. And now the laser beams are going through the amplifiers like 4 times. Each single laser beam, there are 102 of those, has more energy than any other laser in the world. And at least at the moment. And now you see those are all the laser pulses that are propagating within one laser bay. They're coming from the right. There's a similar laser bay happens on the other side. Now they've been distributed all around a target chamber in the up-down geometry. You see the laser pulses here coming from the other side. Here they come from the left side. They're going now from final terminal mirrors through frequency conversion crystals, making green and blue radiation, and then hits our fusion target. The fusion target sits here in the middle, and you see the laser beams entering the fusion target through laser entrance holes and heating up the inside. This whole room here is made out of gold. So it heats up the gold, makes a hot gold plasma that radiates at 300 electron volts. And those X-rays now impinge on our fusion target here. It ablates the ablator. By Newton's third law, you're compressing it, and you burn. That's the idea of this facility. So now here's how it looks like. This is our fusion target. So it looks more complicated than this little cartoon. There's a capsule in the inside. Has a starburn pattern to look actually into the capsule. And then when you see the capsule, you can see the ablator here in dark, and then you see the fuel, the ice layer, sitting right here. That's a real image just before we shot it. And then here, this is a little pipe that puts the DT into the capsule. Another little pipe that puts actually helium, hydrogen gas into the whole room. And you have all kinds of shielding. Okay, and then here's this is a target. That means it's at it's at 18 degrees Kelvin. If you put this in a chamber, which is with a vacuum of 10 to minus 5, all the hydrocarbons in the chamber would just condensate on the target, and you have just water or an ice ball in the target chamber center. So to prevent that, you have a so-called shroud that sits around the target, then you put the target into the chamber. And just before you shoot it, you open the shroud, and then you shoot right away. So if you open the shroud and you don't shoot, experiment is over. You have to start over again. Okay, so then, of course, that was one of the papers that came out, had this picture on the cover. And then this is actually the second shot we ever did on this facility. It came in nicely and round. And those are X-ray diagnostics that were running with it. So those are hard X-rays, and you look through gold here, so 50 microns of gold, and you still see the laser plasma that's been produced from the laser beams hitting the inside of the human wall. The camera here also seeing the laser beams. The other diagnostics around, that measures the total radiation temperature of the 300 electron volts, as I mentioned that to you, is called Dante. You have laser backscattering measurements that tells you how much of the laser light sticks in the whole room. You have hot electron measurements. That means you want to measure the high energy tail of the electrons that have been produced by laser plasma interactions and maybe other processes. And you want to keep them as low as possible, but you still have to monitor them. And you have the measurements, taking measurements of that little dot here. And this is like a gated microchannel plate detector, and you use it in high magnification. And here you see this initial capsule diameter was 2.26 millimeter, and the emitting region now is 50 times smaller than the initial capsule diameter. And it came in round and nice and round, and it has a radius now of 24 microns, so it's highly compressed plasma. You can also look at the neutrons, and the neutrons are actually very similar on this one. This is an X-ray image, it's a neutron image. Neutron image just works like X-ray imaging, you have a pinhole, but for neutrons it's just much bigger and much thicker. And you can also see it came in nice and round, or fairly nice and fairly round. Okay, oh yeah, let's go one back. So we talked earlier about we need to produce a hot, dense plasma, right? Hot, shown here, to make most overlay with our fusion cross-section, dense to have as many processes going on as possible. So what do you guys think? What do we have to measure? Come on, it's easy. What is the first?
Temperature and density.
Okay, temperature, clear. Clearly, we want to measure the temperature of the hotspot, right? The temperature of the cold material, we would like to measure that too, that's hard. Temperature of the hotspot is easy. Why is the temperature of the hotspot easy? Because it emits X-rays and neutrons. Okay, what density do you want to measure? Or what density can you measure? No? Nobody? Is it easy to measure the density of the hotspot? It's not so hard. You have an emitting plasma. If you knew the temperature, you can get the density, of course, just from the emission profile. What is harder to measure? Of course, the density of the shell that sits around, because it doesn't emit, it just sits there. So how do you measure the density of the shell? That requires some advanced thinking. See if that's a good time for a 2-minute break while you think about this. Yes, I think that's a good time for a 2-minute break. So while people want to stretch up and want to think about that question and come back in 2 minutes and let me know how would you measure the density of the shells sitting around our hot plasma in the middle. Okay, let's take a 2-minute break. Thank you. So I think most people are back. Maybe give us 10 more seconds, many seconds.
I don't know if you come to that. This is why I'm asking, should I ask it again? Because in theory, this is not so when it will be done, it's 50 years. So what are the challenges at the moment that keeps it so far in the distant future that keeps it from happening?
Yeah, we can discuss this in the end after you see the rest.
Okay.
I don't address the question completely, but I touch on it, and then we can have a more thorough discussion. Okay, it looks like everybody's back. Okay, so I ask a question. So you have a hot plasma that is emitting radiation in forms of X-rays, actually in forms of gamma rays, in forms of neutrons. But how do you measure the cold stuff that surrounds the hot plasma, the cold fuel? How do you measure that? Yeah, that's a good idea. Actually, so it emits radiation, right? So use the emission itself to tell you what's happening on it, as it goes on the way out. So you could do X-ray scattering. However, that's pretty hard to do. People have not done it. But people just do absorption measurements. So just look at assume you know the temperature from some other diagnostics, and I will tell you how. Then you know how the X-ray spectrum should look like. And if there are features in the X-ray spectrum that are being absorbed, then you know the absorption, or you know the density of the material that has participated in the absorption process. Yeah, so X-ray absorption spectroscopy, that's one way. What is the other way? Yeah? Use the neutrons, right? So neutrons are being produced inside the hot plasma. They're on the way out, they can scatter on the way out. Okay, so here are some diagnostics that I want to show there, of course, but now there are many more. So here's our hotspot, here's our cold field around, and we want to know what's going on. So what we can do activation measurements just to count the neutrons. So you can have like zirconium there, and the neutrons activate the zirconium. And has a half-time of several days. I'll show you that in a second. Then you know the absolute number of fusion processes that have been produced. You have a magnetic recoil spectrometer that measures the downscattered neutrons over the primary neutrons. So remember, they were at 14 MeV, roughly. That means you look at the neutrons that have lost energy, that have been scattered. That tells you how dense the shell was surrounding your hotspot. Actually, one out of 1,000 processes, instead of doing this reaction, the T reaction, they produce a gamma photon. And that gamma photon can also be measured. And you use a gamma photon, you measure that with a Cherenkov detector. Because the gamma photon then hits an electron, that electron zips around at super high speeds, faster than the speed of light in that medium that produces Cherenkov emission. Okay, and then of course there's neutron time of flight. That means the fast neutrons arrive earlier in the detector, and you can measure the velocity distribution function. So let's have a look really fast. So here are some of the processes that are occurring. Here's zirconium, here's copper. When they catch a neutron, you do an end-to-end, so-called end-to-end process. What that mainly means, you produce zirconium 90, you produce zirconium 89. Has a half-time of 3.3 days, so it's optimal. After the shot, you take the material out, and then you start counting the activation particles. And then you can extrapolate back, and you know the total amount of neutrons that hit that piece of zirconium or copper. And here's some counting data from this diagnostic. So that's the total neutron yield. Here's our temperature measurement using neutron time of flight. As I told you, the fast neutrons arrived earlier. Here are two different experiments. One was done with higher laser energy than the other one to produce a higher temperature hotspot. And here you see a tail of neutrons arriving faster than for the other experiment. So it gives us a higher temperature in this case on there. Okay, then we have downscattered neutrons. So you have the primary neutrons. And what you really do, you take those neutrons, and you convert them into deuterium. That means you have a CD foil. CD is just plastic, but instead of hydrogen, it has deuterium. And what that does, it produces a recoil neutron. That means most of the energy has been transferred to the deuterons. So now you have charged particles, and you can put them through a magnet, and that way you can measure a spectrum. That means you convert neutrons to charged particles. And then you have energy resolution. And that way you get the total spectrum signature of primary neutrons and signature of downscaled neutrons. And from that ratio, as this goes up and up and up and up, you know, more and more neutrons are being scattered. That means it's the denser the shell around. That means the more certain it is that alpha particles are being stopped in the fusion plasma and contribute to heating. OK, so gamma ray spectrum, I told you that you also produce gamma rays. And you can set your thresholds of the detector to look at various gamma ray features. But what we really look at is look at the duration of the gamma signal. The duration of the gamma signal tells us the confinement time. In this case, it's around 190 picoseconds. All right, and then here's how it looks like. Here's our primary neutron measurement, downscaled neutron measurement. It's a little bit larger than this one. Here's our X-ray measurement. And here are data that we took from various shots. And after lots and lots of refinement, we call them tuning of the implosions. What happened is the signal of the downscaled neutrons was going up and up and up, almost approaching the point that was required by or was predicted by simulation that we need for these type of implosions. Okay, so here's like an X-ray mission. I told you we can measure the Bremsstrahlung. Go with rho r over square root of temperature, with times square root of temperature. So and here, what we get from here is like we can get this 3.6 kilovolt value for the temperature from our Newton time of flight measurement. From here, we can get the density of the hotspot, for example. Okay. So now we can also look at the difference here between the downscattered and the primary neutrons. I told you from the ratio of the 10 to 12 MeV over 13 to 15 MeV, we get the aerial density. We combine these, so it means we get a 1 gram per cc from there. The difference here tells us it's just a few microns thick. That means we get 550 gram per cc density in our thin shell around. That corresponds to an electron density of 10 to the 26 electrons per cubic centimeter. Our typical metal electron densities are 10 to 23. That's closer to 1,000 times compressed, actually 550 times compressed to be exact. That means the Fermi energy, just calculating that, tells us it's 80 gigabar. So 80 gigabar, remember that. This is far higher than anything you've ever heard of. So that means the p tau, we know, is 190 picoseconds. That means our p tau is 10 atmosphere seconds. And that number is important. So this is just a fuel around. So now the pressures are so high. We know the fuel pressure now. So because the pressures are so high, we actually believe that everything is isobaric. That means if the pressure in the fuel has a certain amount, the pressure in the hotspot should probably be the same, or very close at least. So now let's look at the hotspot pressure. I told you this has 8 times 10 to the 24, 10 to the 24 electrons per cubic centimeter just from the X-ray emission. The temperature was for Newton time of flight, so NKT gives us 92 gigabar or 12 atmosphere seconds. So it's pretty isobaric, so that assumption works good. So two different ways to look at pressures. So magnetic fusion is at 1 atmosphere seconds. It's already 10 times more than magnetic fusion experiments have delivered. So why is that important? So let's look at magnetic fusion experiments over the years. This is, of course, 50 years of magnetic fusion research. And this is one of the first laser-driven points that came about, 2009. And of course, people would like to have ITER here and live there. Those are the goals of those facilities. So just look into this little thing. And here's where we are. So temperatures, 1 to 10 kilovolt, p tau, I told you, in this case, it starts at 1. Here are the other various facilities. And here, experiments that were performed right there. So if the order of 10 atmosphere seconds, but for these type of temperatures, they actually needed to be of the order 30 to 40 for it to produce a burning plasma wave. And here's a simulation that tells you roughly here is a threshold where energy of 1 megajoule will be produced in this type of implosions. OK, so it means you need to have a factor of 3 higher pressure values or confinement times or p tau times, to be exact. okay, here's where we are. And since then, so what is happening? Science editors came out and say fusion falls down. So not good enough, babies. You failed. That was the measure that science gave to the program. Of course, when this was printed like a day later, alpha healing was observed on this. It was really ridiculous. So what happened is here were all the low food experiments. And then what happened is there was a small change made in the existing targets. The targets weren't even changed. Only the laser drive power was changed. What happened is all of a sudden the yields went up to 25 kilovolt, and a lot of the yield came from alpha heating itself. And what is happening is those are simulations that were performed at that time, that the implosion was changed in a way that is less unstable, more stable, to make it a more smooth implosion. And that just led to this increase. And of course, that was then published right away, but not in Science, but in Nature instead. OK, so the only change that was made was this small change in the laser pool chip. And that has led to this big number in alpha heating. OK, so we don't have to discuss this much more. So if you look at the total yield versus compression yield in these type of experiments, the experiments up to there that Science had a look at were going here. And then, of course, within a couple of weeks, these types of measurements were done. You see a significant alpha heating in these experiments. And if you plot it the other way, the yield is right now here. This is the energy required for ignition. And you can see that this is kind of, this was like phase one. This is now phase two. And of course, people now look for changes, for the next change that needs to occur in order to walk up this curve higher. So what is the primary reason why these capsules have not ignited, or are just in phase two, so to speak? What is the next level? It has to be understood in order to go to higher fusion yields. The alternative question of the caller would be, is a bigger facility needed? Or can it be done with existing facilities? That's probably the more important question for fusion scientists. So this is, of course, a calculation. It points to one of the primary difficulties with these experiments. As you're compressing material, the so-called Rayleigh-Taylor instability is one of the most important instabilities that occurs. And it's simply when a light fluid holds a heavy fluid. And a small perturbation can cause mixing. And once you mix material into the hotspot, you quench the hotspot and ignition cannot occur. Actually, what's probably also occurring here is that as you're compressing the fuel, I told you we get a rho r value, right? We have 550 times. This is the density of the fuel. But it's the density of maybe patches of the fuel. It could be that the surrounding shell did actually break open at certain places. And when that occurs, then you squeeze the hotspot out. And you cannot get to full ignition. So stability in these implosions is one of the primary research topics that are right now being addressed. So, and actually, experiments at LCLS can be a key, or are probably very likely a key, to get the physics done right, and to feel the fusion target that is going to be stable. So let's talk about LCLS for a second. I think you've all seen this. I don't think I have to go through this. Good. So, but you have not seen MEC, or did you? Did you go on a tour yet to MEC? Yes. Okay, you've seen MEC. So this is one of the experiments footage from one of the experiments that we did. This is actually a cryogenic hydrogen experiment. You see a scaffolding, and we have actually a hydrogen target that we feel in this experiment. You see Ulf and Eric building up diagnostics inside the target chamber to study properties of dense materials. So here's how we do it. So you have a target here. Actually, we replace it very soon by hydrogen. But let's for now just assume this is just a target that we heat up with our lasers at MEC. The lasers heat up the surface. Newton's third law, you're compressing the rest. So we can study compressed materials or heated materials at MEC. And then we use LCS X-rays to tell us what's going on. So this is our X-ray beam study, and it scatters off our target. And we have area detectors and spectrometers. The array detector measures the bi-sharings, and the spectrometers in forward scatter measurements can measure plasmon oscillation. In backscatter geometry, can measure Compton scattering spectra. When we put this together, lo and behold, we shoot on aluminum, we just get the structural and electronic information that is consistent with the aluminum lattice in this case. So it validates our density function theory for this type of system, no big surprise. But now we do a pump probe experiment. That means we're compressing it and we're probing it at different times. And we're actually compressing it at various delays. That means we can see how our lattice goes first into a compressed lattice. From a compressed lattice goes into a disordered state, a one-lens matter state, until it forms a dense plasma. So we can resolve all the physics that is going on in this regime. And so we have done it on solid-state experiments. I will show you just one or two results at the very end. But I would say that we talked about hydrogen, we talked about microscopic stars, and we talked about the sun. I want to show you our hydrogen experiment. So what we've done, we have fielded a true high repetition rate target for high-power Schauppers laser interactions, and that's a hydrogen jet target. And this is our hydrogen jet target. It's a cryostat here. There's actually some objective to look at the ice that comes out, and the ice comes out here, and you can actually see it down here. So that little stream here is a jet target, and that jet target is 5 microns in diameter. Remember, human hair is roughly 50 microns. It's quite amazing that you can make that photo from over a meter out. But I told you we also have a microscope objective, and that microscope objective told us that our jet is very stable. So it just sits there inside the target chamber. With an RMS jitter of roughly 1 microns, plus minus 1 micron. So now we have cryogenic hydrogen sitting there, so now we can use X-rays to hit it and to study what's going on. And we can also hit it with a laser beam and heat it up and then still study what's going on. And what we use, as I told you earlier, we use an area detector. They're called CS pads to measure the diffraction rings. Here's a forward scattering spectrometer for plus ones, backward scattering spectrometer. And here's another picture of our cryogenic hydrogen jet and actually a laser beam hitting it here, right there. And now we look at data. So now we shoot it at it, and you can see how the ring comes all about, sitting there at 120 hertz, and we can measure a high precision Compton scattering spectrum coming out of the experiment. And we're sitting here, and we accumulate shots, and we accumulate very nice data. So 5,000 shots, 40 seconds, or 70 minutes. Easy to count the time it takes to get a high-precision diffraction measurement from cryogenic hydrogen and velocity distribution function of the electrons. So why does all this work? Why do we actually see diffraction rings? So what happens is, as the liquid being squeezed out of our jet nozzle, it sees a vacuum and the target chamber, cold target chamber. So it comes in, and now there's all this vacuum, so it evaporates. By doing so, it cools down a little bit. And when it cools down, it forms crystallites. And those crystallites give rise to those Bragg rings. So, but now we also have a laser beam. So we have our mixture of ice and liquid. And we heat it up with a laser, this time 5 times 10 to the 18 watts per square centimeter. At 5 hertz, this is the highest this laser can do. While SLS can do 120 hertz, this laser can do 5 hertz. At this point, they can do already higher power laser intensities on target, but that's what we had at this time of the experiment. And now here's a measurement of how we hit it with the laser. This function, this is, I think, done at 1 hertz. Okay, so now we can hit the jet with our X-ray beam, we can hit the jet with our laser beam, but we still have to make sure that they actually hit at the same time or at a controlled time delay. So it means we have to cross-time the X-rays and the optical laser. So how do we do this? So what we do, simply we have a look-through glass sitting here, and this is our optical laser looking through the glass, and now we put the SLS X-ray beams on. And what happens is, while the SLS beam is on, it produces transient carriers, making the glass opaque, but only during that time. So So by doing this technique and then vary the delay between the optical and the x-rays, you can actually cross time the two within 50 femtoseconds. So it's a very high precision measurement of pump and delay. Okay, and here's the data. So what we show here is the temperature as a function of time for various after we heat the material with our laser. So this is the first 30 femtoseconds. What is happening is the laser only talks to the electrons and accelerates the electrons forward. So the electrons go this way, but this is now a dense plasma, and it actually has only positive charges because the electrons are all pushed away. What that gives rise to is, in order for the plasma to stay quasi-neutral, it draws electrons back. So there's a huge electric field that's been set up, and cold or low energy electrons are coming back to make it quasi-neutral again. And that's called a return current. And as the electrons are coming back, there's a current, and that current actually is heating the ions as well. And once the ions are heated, then the whole cryogenic cylindrical plasma is expanding. So that's a process going on. And this is a simulation, so it tells us hot electrons zip out, being pushed forward by the laser. And then you have the thermal electrons, and they actually equilibrate after like 1 picosecond. And then they talk to the ions and give energy to the ions down here and makes the whole hydrogen hot and warm. But the problem is we have a standard model for electron-ion collisions. And it tells us that the ions should be much, much hotter than what we observe. That's the so-called Lee-Moore model, and it overestimates electron-proton collisions by a lot, actually. So now what people have done since then, there's been a theory for electron-ion interactions in a very dense hydrogen plasma, or a very dense system. And independent, we didn't know of each other, but we coded the theory using the electron data here. We find excellent agreement. So, and of course, people at the moment, as they're designing their experiments for implosion experiments on NIF, they use that theory that we believe is not correct. So right away, you can see how SLS can lead the way into testing the theory and pointing towards which theory is the right one to use as you're planning your fusion experiments at other facilities. Okay, and of course, that had impact beyond fusion. So that was a lot of talk about fusion, but actually we are not really, SLAC is not actually much known for as a fusion research laboratory until I came, but now we are also apparently a planetary physics model because there's a Juno mission. So Juno was launched like 2011. It's a spacecraft that flies to Jupiter. And as it goes around Jupiter, it measures with high precision the magnetic field and the mass distribution inside Jupiter. And the goal really is to find out, does Jupiter have a solid core or not? So, and that's important, of course, because if Jupiter has a solid core, it tells us how the planetary system came about. So it tells us an evolutionary story. If it's solid, then there was a solid core that has swept up all the hydrogen, and that way has accumulated all the mass that was in the initial disk. If it's not a solid core, then those planets have probably been produced by local instabilities. All right, in any case, Discovery Channel saw our papers that came out, interviewed me about all this stuff, and saw SLS. And you can see that now, by measuring these equation of states, by having models out there that are now been tested in the laboratory for the very first time, the planetary physicists will now use these models to actually tell whether Jupiter has a solid core or not. Because they cannot look inside Jupiter. They don't have x-rays like we do. So they have to rely on these type of models that we can test here. Okay, then another example that I thought was really nice was a planetary impact study that we just completed. So here we compress graphite. So as you're compressing graphite, this is shown here, this is pressure on the y-axis, density on the x-axis. It means you walk this way, you're at 2.2 gram per cc, you're compressing. As you hit 3.5 gram per cc, you turn graphite into diamond. So So that was interesting. That's actually the first time people have actually seen that phase transition this way, in situ, in the laboratory, just by looking at the X-ray diffraction. But then as we kept going up in pressure, okay, you may think it's boring, just diamond, but at about 2 megabar, you see another shift in the data. It shifts over. And that shift is because now diamond goes into a lonsdaleite state, which is not a cubic form of diamond, but a hexagonal form of diamond. So why is that interesting? Lonsdaleite was found in medial impact crater sites. So now we can actually have a gauge at medial impact crater sites telling you how big the pressure was as the meteor has hit Earth. Okay, that also just came out in Nature Communications. So coming back to fusion plasma, so I told you about this the model that we tested with bar root, telling you what is the right model to use in hydrogen. So there are a bunch of other models that are being used. And actually, so some call it the Thomas-Fermi model, which is hard to see now here because the authors that published this one have shown it in green, and they used our data from MEC in black. And you can see that the Thomas-Fermi model is not consistent with our experimental data. Yet the Thomas-Fermi model is what everybody uses as a designing fusion experiments. And the more appropriate one to use is the Kohn-Sham functional, and then of course it shows, which is a red curve, validating the shortcomings of one model and saying what is the right model to use. Another study here that just came out in PRL shows us, again, there's a whole zoo of theories. Actually, if I would have all the theories, there would be even more. However, the data point is just here, and it tells us again that certain models that are being in use are just inadequate. And the last one, which is actually a lot of interest for the solid-state community, is this one. So density function theory is a theory of choice for studying dense many-body systems. And what people have been using is the so-called PBE functional. So when people tell you DFT is first principle, doesn't need any experiments to be validated, guess what? They're wrong. Even the most fundamental many-body physicists look at experimental data as their construction, their functionals. So, and this is the one that has been mostly used in cold systems. But as you go to hotter and hotter systems, there have been no data up till now that tell us what functionals do we need to use. And now we believe we have the first data here, which is the spectrum shown here in black again. And there's a so-called HSE functional, which just gives better agreement with the experimental data compared to the PBE. So again, we can tell you the models that are in use for our fusion plasmas are not adequate. And we can actually point out what models need to be used in order to accurately simulate our plasma. Okay. With this, what needs to happen next in fusion research? We believe you have to develop a solid understanding of matter in extreme conditions. And I've given you now quite a few examples how SLS has tested our fundamental science understanding of high energy density plasmas. If you could use this understanding and design the correct experiments, or design the experiments correctly, let's put it that way, we should be able to demonstrate fusion in the laboratory. That means we should have gains of order 50 to 100 with laser fusion. And then, of course, if that works, we can even think of advanced fuel. We can think of boron proton fusion and get to much, much higher gain and much more fusion yield, much higher fusion yield. And then we need to still develop efficient drivers and target technology. Right now, from 3 shots a day, we need to go to 10 shots a second. And that's probably will require a push in laser technology, direct pump lasers, or in different type of beam driver technologies that can deliver that. So with this, I want to conclude that fusion research is still very much a fundamental science program. We're still testing what models are important, what models do not work, what models need to are correct. However, I believe you need to be ready with fusion in this century for the sake of us all. With this, I'd like to conclude. Thank you. Take your questions. And I think we should have time for discussion. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks a lot. Absolutely fascinating. I'm sure there are questions. Yeah.
I have two.
Can everybody hear, or shall I bypass?
So you have these 102 laser pulses to start the fusion. I just wanted to ask how long are the pulses, and then what time window do they have to arrive at the target? So basically, how hard is it to match the path length of 102 laser pulses?
So that means you're asking the cross timing, right? So first of all, the pulses are typically 15 nanoseconds long, right? A foot per nanosecond, that means they're like 10 feet in space, actually. So it's pretty easy to adjust 10 feet, actually. But you do it with a target experiment. So what you do, you have a thin gold disk. You fire, like, say, 40 beams on that thin gold disk. And you have an X-ray street camera. You look at the answer of the X-ray emission. And then you make final adjustments to bellows. And those are like mirror systems that can move in and out without changing the path, just change the delay. And then that has been done over and over again to get them to cross time to better than 10 picoseconds, I believe.
And maybe a second question, is there currently an experiment running that investigates how you create the tritium out of lithium and the neutron? Because that's, is there currently an experiment going on that investigates how you create the tritium out of lithium and neutrons? Because that's not easy, I presume.
So that's only been done, that's not been done with thermal fusion neutrons, right? This has been done with standard collision experiments. For example, you have nuclear reactors and they put lithium next to it and they bombard it with neutrons. So, and as far as I know, nobody has found any surprises. The issue with this type of idea, when you have your lithium there, you don't want the lithium to be solid and just sitting there. You want it actually to be liquid. You want to have a liquid lithium blanket. And then you want that lithium to get out. I want to extract the tritium, and then you want to put the lithium back in. And I think that type of scheme has not been tested yet, and that will need more work. Yes.
I have some questions. So first thing I want to say, I like the idea of having fusion reactors in the future, but still I have some critical questions. So I hope you could just, don't take them as I want to take it down. The first thing is, as I mentioned before, the theory sounds really well, but if you ask experimentalists or people that try to design these things, it's always, no matter when you ask them, it's at 50 years. It just keeps on going and it looks like it's just not happening. What do you think is the biggest challenge that people have to face to really can make the prediction that actually in 50 years it will work?
So right now, this is a proof of principle, right? And I've shown you that the science editors just had the same idea like you. You have just thrown some stones, and actually the very next day they were proven to be wrong. Because alpha heating is now being observed. And alpha heating was one of the critical steps that needed to occur. And when people say 50 years, I hope they don't think the fusion process has to be demonstrated in 50 years, because that's stupid. It occurs in the sun every day, right? So we don't have to demonstrate that. That's already, nature already does it for us. So what I think the key thing that needs to happen is, even if NIF, for example, would demonstrate fusion in a single shot, what are all the science and technology that has to occur to make a power plant? And you're absolutely right, that will be 50 years. Maybe it's going to be 25, I don't know. That's going to be a big deal. It's going to be a lot of money to do that. But nobody will invest, nobody will do that without demonstrating a burning plasma, right? So that's definitely the step that has to do. You have to put a megajoule in and 10 megajoule out, something like that. That's when people pay attention. That's when the US government will pay attention. That's when private capital will set in. So at the moment, I think that's still a true statement. It's still a fundamental science program. It's not an applied program yet. So moving from fundamental science to applied programs, you need to demonstrate the critical milestone.
I mean, there is already a program, I mean, ITER in France, that they plan to do, but this is actually a different technique. So there tries to be applicable. I would like to compare this to the experiment at NIF. So I can see how ITER might work with just continuous, like putting some more fuel into it and just let it burn with the energy that's already in the reactor, just using the heat from the fusion before to initiate the next one. So here at NIF, you just have a target that each one costs like, I don't know, how many $100,000, and has to be designed really well. The gold must be in really well shape. It must be positioned at a really exact place, and you will have to do this at then 10 shots per second. That sounds more like you won't be able to make a power plant of this. So is NIF just really for researching what's happening there? Mm-hmm. Because
So let's compare for a second magnetic fusion to inertial conformal fusion. So magnetic fusion, as you all know, there was a TFTR in Princeton, a big tokamak. And TFTR was shut down with the promise of a new facility that never came. However, after TFTR was shut down, actually researchers found post-mortem evidence for alpha heating even in TFTR. And now looking back, it looked to have been absolutely stupid to shut down that facility. And so sometimes politics takes the lead and actually makes a lot of decisions that are just wrong and really hurt science and really hurt progress as well. So, however, but in all reality, we are living in a political environment. We cannot just isolate ourselves from the politics. So, and there's a reason now why ITER has been built in France, in Cadarache. And so I think your question is, you see how ITER would work. Remember, ITER will just be fundamental science. We'll still not be an applied program. Even if ITER works, ITER is a cubical 10 machine. It will not even be a burning plasma. It will not igniting. Remember, when we ignite with laser fusion, it will be Q of infinity, right? Because you have cold and you make energy out of cold fuel. That will not be the case at ITER. So even if ITER works to spec and maybe even a little bit better than spec, it still not be enough. That means there has to be another facility afterwards that demonstrates PowerPoint type, a power plant type of operation with a queue of hundreds to infinity, and that can handle all the material issues. So when you ask the question, who is ahead, who is behind, it's not clear. At the moment, we do experiments over there, we do experiments here at LCLS, and we're making progress. And from a fundamental science program perspective, that's actually a dream for scientists, for physicists.
I mean, for just the fundamental science, it's great what NIF does. I'm just skeptical of that people saying, okay, what we do here at NIF is actually something that is applicable in the future power plant. I just don't see it coming that these really manufacture these.
Yes, let me address that too. So the question, of course, is can you ever do 10 hertz operation? Can you ever do 100 hertz operation? So at one level, you ask yourself, okay, how fast does a machine gun shoot, right? I mean, it's not so hard to do this, actually, to solve it. What is harder to think of is that really the best way of doing it? And the question is probably, even if NIF ignites, is that really the best way to go forward? And I have my doubts myself. It may not be the best way to go forward. We may find better ways to do fusion. But without having a fusion plasma, it's still just theory. It's still just writing a textbook, and people read a textbook, it will have no meaning in terms of any political decision. If NIF, or in Bordeaux, or Shenyang 4 ignites and produces a burning plasma, then all the theoretical talk will become very, very much real. And then people will pay a lot of attention, and then not only the community will think about what is the best way to do a fusion plasma, also politics and venture capital will think the same way. What is the best way to make a fusion plasma? And then the ball will be set in motion. And then we will go from fundamental science to applied science. So at the moment, I don't think you need to carry this dream to the extreme and say NIF is going to be what a future power plant looks like. It's not needed. You don't have to go there.
Okay. And then for the initial, the initial motivation that you had in the beginning, the renewable energy. Was I asking too much?
No.
Okay. Okay, in the beginning you said we basically had the energy need of the world and all the different techniques and how much they cost. I mean, if it's at least 50 years or longer that fusion will be there, that we can really use it, I mean, till then I think the renewable energy will just take over and have everything already. So.
But you see that that's not the case.
I mean,
it's just not true. I've shown you data from India and China that these countries burn coal. that don't use renewable energy. It's not taking over. And after India, it will be another country. The data that you that we have at our hand show that renewable energy sources are the solution for the rich countries. That's the data we have. And that's what we probably have to go with for the next decade or so. It can be just like nuclear power plants, it can be put anywhere. And it does not have the proliferation risk, like, as you know, there was Atoms for Peace, right, in the 50s, and Eisenhower put nuclear plants, fission plants into India. But of course, what the Indians used, they made atomic bombs with it. That will not be the case with the fusion plant. So there's geopolitical thinking that has to be included here. But it is definitely a way, it's a technology that can be exported to poor countries.
It's a good discussion, I think, but on the 50-year point, there was an announcement a few months ago from GE with a tokamak solution that they said would be available in 10 years' time commercially. Is the science of that wrong? Is there a mistake in the calculations? Because that's based on existing technology of the science of fusion. And I didn't see any outright criticism of it, and I'm wondering if you have an opinion about that.
Yeah. So that specific one I have not read. Actually, the last 2 years there has also been one from MIT and actually one from Sandia as well. And people are actually expecting lawsuits because, you know, you cannot just make outright this type of comments and be on the stock market and, you know, not delivering. So I cannot comment on specifically on the one at GA, but even then, people will say, hey, where does the rubber hit the ground, right? So actually do it. Once you do it, we will have a shift in paradigm. But as long as there's no demonstration, I don't believe, it's just hot air, right?
Okay, further questions? Or we can continue solving the world's energy crisis at lunch. So let's thank Siegfried again.
Thank you.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.